You are now listening to the Artist King Podcast.
Welcome to the Artist King Podcast, number 25. I am your host, DTM. In this podcast, we will hear the complete panel discussion of this past Tuesday, November 4th, The Balance of Art, Creativity, and Life. This panel discussion is the last of the Artist King panel discussions going on around Atlanta, and they included Burnaway, C4 Atlanta, and WonderRoot. Our panelists this past Tuesday were Eric Nine Lopez, Brian Aber, Neal Hamilton, and myself. And it took place at WonderRoot. Artist King is a nonprofit organization committed to empowering artist entrepreneurs through education, community, coaching, and connections. Artist King recognizes that art is everywhere and the artist is indispensable. Artist King is sponsored by the law offices of Deborah Gonzalez, Atlanta Tech Village, C4 Atlanta, WonderRoot, Burnaway, RevolveSkate.com, Rick Clear Video, and Velocity Screen Print. Please visit ArtistKing.org for the complete Artist King 2014 panel discussions, now available on podcast, plus info on the upcoming end-of-the-year group art show, The Way of the Artist, this November 22nd at Atlanta Tech Village in Buckhead ATL. The Way of the Artist Group Art Show will feature tunes by Mr. E, LAE 2014 Class Graduation, Day Black Short Film Screening written by Keith Cross, Pencil Wars Drawing Contest, a Sticker Trade Table, over 20 ATL artists showing off their best work, a body painting competition, art giveaways courtesy of attorney Deborah Gonzalez, plus Kid Robot Money World giveaways from RevolveSkate.com, and a chance to win an Adobe Creative Cloud subscription given away by the Adobe User Group ATL. The Way of the Artist Group Art Show is produced by Mano a Mano Art Shows and Artist King. Visit us on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook under Mano a Mano Art Shows and also Artist King _ATL. The Way of the Artist, November 22nd, 8 p.m. to 1 a.m., Atlanta Tech Village in Buckhead. Tickets are $5 and available online at mono2014.eventbrite.com. And now, on to the Artist King Podcast featuring the Balance of Art, Creativity, and Life discussion panel.
My name is Eric Nine. Like you said, freelance artist here in Atlanta for about 10 years. Before moving here, I worked at an ad agency. For 4 years, I started on the buying side, buying radio and TV spots, and kind of learned a lot about target market audience strategies of how to use advertisements effectively. Some really big clients and... So I actually didn't start on the creative side, I started on the other side just to kind of get in. And then moved my way to the creative side, doing storyboards and designing stickers and whatever I could do to get deeper into the creative side. Came to Atlanta and I got an internship at a graphic design company and they showed me this whole new thing called the flyer hustle, and it was very weird because I didn't know how easy it was to, it just surprised me that I could make a living and I didn't have to go, you know, how school trains you to go through a corporate route or make a resume so you can get a job, work for somebody. At this internship, they had me designing flyers. I designed 2-3 flyers a day. They would sell these flyers for $100, $150 each. I was only making $300, $325 a week. After I interned, they hired me and they paid me $325 a week. So I did that for 3 months and quit. And in that 3 month time, I just made sure I had my, you know, what I'm going to do. I'm going to do this flyer thing. And instead of doing 10 to 15 flyers a week for less than $400, I was... changed it up and was just doing 5 to 6 flyers a week, making twice as much money, and that's how I started freelancing. And from there, grown to billboards, storyboards for videos you see on TV, and now creating and selling my own art. So that's my story in a nutshell.
All right. Yep. Well, thank you.
I love it. My name is Neal Hamilton. Here we are again. Welcome, everybody. I'm currently CEO of Paint Out Loud, my own company I've had for about 10 years now. Starting off, like I said, back when we were young, I was actually, I didn't tell the story before, an industrial designer. I actually was into my first real job in the corporate world was I was actually designing tow motor trucks, okay? And then from there, I got a big-time job as a lighting designer at a lighting company of all that. I never tell too many people these stories. And so, you know, I was always on the drafting board. So I was on the mechanical side of things before I really got over to the art side of things, because that was really paying the bills at the time. Okay, I mean, I've done some really cool stuff lighting. I mean, I actually did some of the lighting for the Broadway Theater in New York and stuff like that, you know, but I just didn't want to tell anybody. I just wanted to get through that. I wanted to get downtown. I was in Cleveland, Ohio at the time. I wanted to get downtown and become an illustrator. And it was like one major firm that had all the best of the best illustrators, and you could never get in the door. I would just pound that door down every 2 weeks with my portfolio trying to get in the door. And then they would always tell you when you're young, well, you need more experience. I'm sure we've heard that before, right? How do you get more experience if nobody gives you a chance to get experience? But I still kept pounding the door, and I kept improving my portfolio until they finally said, all right, come on in. We're going to hire you. Okay, bud. So I got to be amongst such great illustrators, and now I'm really happy. I'm around people like Norman Rockwell types, you know, who have been there for years, and they know how to do all this advertising stuff. So we're learning. Back in those days, there were no computers. There were nothing like people have today. Everything was manually done, from Ruby list to typesetting to all this stuff. I don't even know if people know what that even is these days, right? Okay, so you know what I'm talking about. Registration marks, right? That kind of stuff. So, you know, there was a wealth of things to be learned there. And I'm so glad that we did it, you know, because if the power goes off, I can still complete an art project, right? And then from there, after those years, you know, I've met some cool people that like moved next door to my studio, my little cubicle that were out of New York City and stuff. And we got along good. We always talked about we need to start our own company. Somebody must have overheard us in the company, because like the next week we're all getting laid off. No, I'm serious. Somebody heard something. So we're like, well, geez, okay. We just go down to the unemployment line, and I remember while we're in the unemployment line, we were the happiest people in that building. Everybody else was all sad because they, you know, lost their jobs. We were so excited to get our little paycheck because we knew we were going to start our own company. We were free to start our own commercial art firm. So we would get our little unemployment check and then go right over to this building we found. And every night we were in there sawing and cutting and sanding and shaping this place to be our new company, which we did name Livewire Studios. I was the president of Livewire Studios. We had our first commercial firm. Then we were competing against the company that fired us. How beautiful is that, right? Wow. So that went on. I owned that company for about 5 to 6 years, you know, and then everybody went other ways. My friends and partners went to Disney and other places, and I'm like, that's great. And I took a break, and then I got hired by the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame to be their chief photographer and stuff. So that just really set the world on fire, in a sense, because I got to be around my musical friends I love so much, you know. So I was able to take my artistic abilities and put it behind a camera lens for a little while. And then after that, after my 10 years there, I had a disaster. My home burns down in a fire. I lose my studio, and all kinds of crazy stuff happens. And I had stopped painting, actually, for a while. For the 10 years at the Rock Hall, I was paid a lot of money to be around rock stars. Hey, I'll do it. But the fire made me see something different when I had to move the family to another house. You know, thank God we had kept my parents' house. I picked up a blank canvas one day and decided to do something I never did. But I lost everything in the fire. I didn't have any tools. I didn't have paintbrush. I didn't have nothing. I found an old piece of canvas, and I looked around. There's some old leftover house paint in the corner somewhere. And I took that and developed the body of work that I now am known all over the world for. Yeah. Okay? So I've been, and the subject matter, too, is the musical people that I admire. So Paint Out Loud is applied to a lot of the music giants in the world that we have all grown to know so dearly in this life. So that has really grown into a beautiful, beautiful thing now. So once again, it came from someplace else, because I sure wasn't thinking about it. Right. And to this day, I moved down to Atlanta about 3.5-4 years ago and met Dan. He's like one of the first people I met. You know, I'm drawn to this stuff. You know? And the rest is kind of, you know, we're on that trajectory now, you know, going to build the dream of, It's been laid out in front of, like our destinies are. Mm-hmm. We have to pay attention to where that is coming from. You have to pay attention. No matter how crazy it sounds, follow your lights, because it will lead you to where you need to go.
Yes. Wow. No, man. Definitely.
Thank you.
Man, my name is Brian Abear. I'm from Los Angeles, California. I grew up all my life drawing. I always liked drawing, but never really got formal training until I got to, like, really to college. I went to a HBCU in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, called Southern University. But when I was in high school, I went to Morningside High School, same high school Byron Scott, who played for the Lakers, went to. Lisa Leslie, I was in class with her and some other people. It was my art teacher at Morningside that kind of set me in the right direction, Miss Sykes. She sees this video, I would just give a huge shout out to Miss Sykes. She was right on time. But she kind of had me doing banners for the basketball games and stuff like that. It just kind of got me started and into like organized art direction. And I took what she gave me and got in an art contest and won like second prize or something, won some money. I was like, oh man, you know. And at that point I was like, okay, I can do something with this.
That's right.
But I ended up applying to school. School was just like, let me just get by this. I wasn't really, I'll graduate, but I do want to do something. You know what I mean? So I was in that place at that time. So when I got this art direction, a guy that went to my school who ran track, went to Southern University like a year or two before. He graduated a year or two before me. I have a twin sister. Let me just say this. And so JoJo was the guy's name. JoJo went to Southern. He came back with this video school kind of recruiting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, y'all got to go. And at the time, I had chicken pox. So I missed the video. I missed that opportunity. And when I got back, everybody was all excited. Oh, man, you got to see. We're going to Southern. And so many people was excited about going to the school in Louisiana. I was like, which I have family in Louisiana, but I never really been down there. So I was like, all right, So I check out the information, and it looks exciting. So I apply to school. Actually, I applied to Tuskegee and Southern. Tuskegee denied me. Southern said, come on in. So I end up, and right before I go to Southern, Tuskegee said, oh, sorry, we denied you. Come on in. And I was like, oh, okay. So I went to Southern, and when I got there, I ended up majoring in art. And that was it for me. It was the best experience ever for me. If I had a chance to do it again, I'd do it the same. I get to Southern, get in the art department. I'm in there starting basic design, drawing, and it's all beautiful because I'm loving. This is my element. I'm like, this is it for me. So I'm in it. First student art show comes up, and I'm like, man, I got this little piece I'm working on at the house, on this drawing paper. I'm thinking this the bomb, I'm like, yo, this is the piece right here. And I show it to the instructor, Professor Cox, which he was my drawing instructor and a great mentor. So I show him the piece, and he's like, because he has to approve of this. Like, yeah, he's looking at it. He's like, this, nah. So I was like, oh, man. Like, it was like, ugh. But it was good because the next year I came with it, like, extra. To the point where I'm just laying the pieces out. He like, man, dude, just giving me major props. And just making me feel like, yo, you earned this. It wasn't no, I'm not giving you nothing. So from that point on, it was on. So every show I was in it, I was learning how to organize and curate, like really curate an exhibition. Formulate it, make it flow, learn how to hang a show, install it completely, clean a gallery. So I learned all of that there. He gave me everything I needed to know in undergrad. So by the time I came out, drawing was really my foundation. So I became very strong at drawing, learned sculpture, coil and slab techniques. I was lost wax process, doing all this stuff. So when I came out of there, I was really drawing. But I knew everything I needed to know. Mind you, while I'm there, I meet this woman, this female. We end up becoming boyfriend and girlfriend, later got married. We're both from California, so we moved back to California. I'm doing murals, freelancing, I'm selling prints. And really, I got out, I was just hustling. Mm-hmm. Prints, murals in restaurants, whatever, just getting it. But I was like, I do need a job, I do need something to be consistently paying the bills. So